How did you feel when you were about to become a father for the first time? JJ, how did you feel?
So I remember when we found out we were pregnant, because my wife's reaction was, oh shit. And I was like, yes. And like, it wasn't quite synced. And I was like, yes, still. I didn't care about her. But I guess what it is if you, I took it like day by day, and I was quite like, I didn't want to jinx anything. So the whole like pregnancy period, I had all the like apps, like, oh, you know, his nails just grown. Oh, you know, their eyeballs, like it's the same size their whole life, and all this kind of nonsense, just to prepare myself. And that was my way of like keeping calm, not feeling the pressure. So I just took it day by day. Like we took each milestone. And then when he came, it was like, all right, let's just do it milestone by milestone and go keep the boy alive. Like, you know, feed, each nappy, each sleeping. Before you know it, your confidence kind of grows. And then I was able to start forming opinions and stuff. I remember at the very, very beginning, it was kind of like overwhelming, thinking, will I be able to do it? All this pressure, everyone's telling me what I shouldn't be doing. So I just tried to just break it down. And I think it was just my way of able to deal with it as well and be more supportive, obviously, to my missus as well. Because learning tidbits and just like reassuring her, I gave her the false sense of security. I knew what I was doing. Mm. So then she felt a bit confident that she could ask me stuff.
You gotta do that. I think we were a little bit later in having kids, and I think my main thing was gratitude. I was like totally grateful. It was like, it's happening. This is a big thing. Wow. All right. And then it was the thing about, oh, what about her? But what's she going to go through? Because obviously the physical changes and stuff are bigger for her, but then there's a whole load of stuff you have to deal with. Information overload was a thing. You took something from it. I hated it. I hated the websites and all the things and the mum's nets and all that kind of stuff were too much in there, because it was like, you look, Google stuff, and you get 15 different versions of what's going to be happening at any given moment, both before birth and after birth, to the point at which I was stubbornly kind of like, it'd be fine. But I think you need some of it, because you come from nothing going, oh, suddenly this thing's going to happen. But I just remember feeling like really sort of, it sounds really hippy-dippy, but centered about it. It was like, cool, this is what we're here for. This is a purpose. This is work's one thing. We both got kind of our own sense of worth from that. But it's, the next stage of human being is going, this is kind of cool. This is all right. We're here now. We're doing what my mum and dad did. So I felt kind of nice. And then it all happens, and then you'll go and sleep at nights, and it becomes a different thing. But for that moment there, it was like, this is quite, yeah, this is click, this is right, this is human beings doing what they do, kind of thing.
No, I think I felt very much the same. And you talk about me feeling centered, and I did feel quite calm. We were married for 4 years before we had our first child, but we did plan to have a first child. We're like, okay, yeah, we felt ready. And I remember like the moment or the season where my heart just changed, and I felt like, oh, actually, I'm ready to be a dad now. Whereas before, we were acutely aware that parenthood wasn't really on the radar. We were just cool, we were working professionally, you know, we were doing our thing, and that was fine. We weren't ready to be responsible for another life. But so when we were pregnant, we were like, okay, yeah, this is cool. And I remember feeling quite calm and quite relaxed. I came from a big family, so there are six of us, like in terms of siblings. I'm right in the middle. So I've been a younger sibling and I've been an older sibling. So I guess the idea of a baby was just quite exciting and sort of quite familiar, you know, having two younger siblings. So yeah, really quite calm. I really enjoyed the process and the hormones and all of that stuff. Yeah, that was all very interesting.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was a really nice sort of grounded experience, actually.
Yeah. I was ready, like you were saying, you were ready. I think I was definitely ready by the time.
Yeah.
Because, you know, they say women get broody. Yes. I think I was seeing, like, families. And I was like, you know what? I'm ready to do this thing. Yeah. So I think initially I was quite happy. But then I realised that you can't... It was the first time I realised I couldn't control stuff. So my wife would be driving to work. And I was talking about her yesterday. And she was saying, I used to remind her or actually say to her, oh, are there stairs at your workplace? You know, make sure you're going to be okay. You know, because I felt that worry about her.
Yeah.
And you realise I can't control... She's out there, she's traveling on her own. So for me, that was the hard thing to kind of get my head around, is like just making sure she's okay. But I think I did have an overwhelming sense of like, wow, this is going to happen. You know, it's an amazing thing, I guess. But yeah, it's interesting. I think so.
We weren't planned.
Oh, you weren't planned.
We weren't planned. That's why my wife would like shit. So it was, we were living in my mum's house, and my mum's got like a loft, which is like a little studio, and we were doing up our house. And the whole plan was like, oh, we'll do the house up, we'll enjoy like our house, and then we'll have kids and stuff. And we'd kind of like, she fell pregnant, and she's like, you got to sort that house out now. Like, I'm like, I'm in there like trying to sort the house out and stuff. And you know, like you talk about the whole pregnancy stuff. I was like you, I was all the time on her case. Are you drinking enough water? Are you eating properly? I don't know if really, and I didn't used to drive either. This is how unprepared. I passed my test just before like she went into labor and stuff. With the whole point being that I can drive so that she has her baby and stuff. And the whole time she was just like, she didn't care. She was just get on with life. So, oh, let's book a holiday, our last trip away. Let's do this and let's do that. I was like, no, man, I'm so worried. Like, I'm so stressed about you. You don't seem to care. But I joke about it now. I was like, oh, I really liked you pregnant, you know. Like, you were so cool and calm. Like, I want you to be pregnant.
It's year long.
Just relax.
What about you?
Just the thing about what James said about it. There's no right time. There's no perfect time. You can line everything up as much as you think to, but it's going to, it happens. And if you're lucky enough to have it, it's like, all right, well, what do we do now? And it's, but that's, I think that sets you up for when they're actually born, because that's life. When they're born, you don't know on a given day what the hell is going to happen in the next day. So basically, you're living like that. You're living like, okay, are we not having a holiday for 3 years or 4 years or 5 years? So they go to school. Do we not? Because we don't want to go on a plane with a pushchair. Or you just got to go, well, there's a problem. Let's go. Every week is a sort of problem solving thing. So, I mean, we were ready for it. But like I said, we were slightly older. So we were kind of coming at it from a very different perspective. We went along to some of these parent groups prenatal stuff and to learn about things, which were useful, but there was a lot of people and it was just funny because one, we're not in a traditional arrangement, i.e. my wife's job's much more important and she earns a lot more than me, so it was always agreed from the start that we were going to try and do shared parental leave and me take on a big proportion of the parental care, which was great. So it was already a little bit kind of different to how a lot of people experience the whole process, other than pre being born. She's obviously taking all the load and all that kind of stuff. But afterwards, it was like, well, how do we make it so we both can do this? How do we make it so it's equal to everything is there? You go to these kind of meet other people, and they're like, kind of, it's all on the woman, all on the woman, and it's just like almost an agreed sort of societal norm that the dad gets a little bit. You're not involved in this. Like, any questions were directed from health visitors, from parents, from grandparents. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, how's the baby? But so for us it was like, well, how do we make it work for us as a little unit? And that's where we started from, I think.
Did that stress you out, like the whole kind of, so obviously like when we were pregnant, we're preparing for the baby to come, but she's still preparing, oh, I'm gonna have birth. I mean, she was stressing about the birth mostly, but she's like, I'm gonna have to look after him for a bit, you're gonna go back to work. Were you like the opposite? You're like, oh, I've only got 2 more months of freedom and then I'm at home like with the baby.
Weirdly not. Weirdly, I was like, I was ready. I don't know why. I don't know what was leading me up to it. Because I'm a teacher, so I'm used to like, you know, 7 to 7 all the days, hours, just because secondary school teaching is like that, and that's how I work. It's like, so I was ready for, it was gonna be weird. It was gonna be weird how it would change, but it was also like, well, done that for 14 years, full-time teaching all the way through, every day, every term, you know. And it's like, well, oh, if this comes to a point now, all right, it's not so bad. So I don't have to get up at 6 or 5 every morning. I don't have to drive. Yeah. All right, so it's going to be a different thing. So I didn't see it that way. So more as a, how do I help do what I've got to do for my wife and the little one? Because it was like, this is an opportunity. I'm not going to get this together. To be honest, we didn't think we were going to have kids. Full stop. So it turns up, that's what I say about gratitude. So maybe a skewed perspective, maybe our viewpoint is a little bit biased towards that kind of thing, but we were like, let's do this. We could have been another couple of years and it ain't gonna happen. So it's like kind of a different thing. So, and we've got friends who've gone through various things who didn't have kids. Yeah. So we were mostly positive, I think. The scared stuff, I think, happened when they actually arrived. But the pre stuff was all, let's go, this is good.
So one thing I found, before fatherhood, I had obviously had a job, still have a job, but I used to make music, make a little music at home. I had a little room with a studio room, and that was my little kind of cave, my little man cave, my little getaway. And then I kind of left it as long as I could to start clearing out that room. Until it got to about 6 months in, I was like, do you know what? I've got to start actually cleaning this room now. I remember just kind of like, I sold some of my equipment. I had a big Mac, sold that, got a little laptop. I just kind of moved and everything else. It was sad, man. It was very sad. But for me, not only like the, is my wife going to be okay, but it was actually, how am I going to still do the things I want to do after becoming a father? Would I have to just stop making music altogether? Will I just have no life other than just, you know, being a dad and a husband going to work? And thankful enough, that hasn't transpired. Actually, I do get time now, as my daughter's a little bit older now. But how did you guys feel? Did you guys feel like worried about that, or was that something that you were ready for?
Yeah, you know what? That's an interesting question. I think because I'm a musician as well. So I was working as a teacher as well, working as a teacher and, you know, full-time responsibility. So our lives were very sort of routined and regimented, and we were quite involved in our community church. And so there was lots of things we were doing, and our lives were always very multifaceted. So when kids came along, that was, for me, that was, I don't want to call it the perfect excuse, but it was a really good reason to start scaling back on certain areas. And I think when the kids came along, I was like, right, I actually want to kind of put some things down now that I was responsible for. Not necessarily with work, but I guess mainly sort of extra things outside of work and so forth. And, but in terms of the sort of musical pursuits and the other creative pursuits, we did have to renegotiate how we kind of used our time. And that was interesting for me because I've always needed a creative outlet. I've always needed something to do, whether it was Thursday night football or sitting by the piano or writing a song or in the studio. So I actually just went on like a mad kind of fitness thing. So I was like, I used to go to the gym like in my 20s and stuff. Then I sort of stopped and got married and was like, yeah, you know, hey, everything's all right. We're cool. You know, I'm just maintaining. I'm in maintenance season. And then when the kids came along, I needed something because I wasn't really getting the time musically and creatively. And I just went nuts. And I bought the Insanity like DVD, and I was just doing that. I did that whole program. Then I did another one, like a 30-day shred. It was like every day was just like sweating it out. Like I remember my wife being, oh my gosh, but seriously, on the sofa with the first baby, and I'm like in the living room, like sweating and working out and like checking on her, and she's behind just watching. And I was like, yeah, that I think when I'm looking back, because I don't do that now. Like I train, but I'm not as intense as I was. And I think looking back, that was definitely a kind of coping mechanism for like just channeling like just that whole experience. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? Like, once the baby was there.
I mean, you have these great plans. I think that's the thing. You sort of like, hindsight is a wonderful thing, but you go through it and go like, these are the plans. This is what we intend to do. And then when you get into it, you go, oh, this ain't happening. This is what, and you do end up, and it goes in waves. I mean, first year is one thing, second year is another thing, and then we're going in a third year with a new but second one along. And it's like, well, that's another different thing again. Absolutely. And it's like, and you end up doing the thing you were saying about compromise, and that's about the foundation of if your relationship and making sure that, you know, because one, the work of your wife or partners are equally important as is what you're doing, but then they've got to be aware of you needing what you need to get your outlet in. And I think it's just, if that openness, I think I felt lucky that we could talk about everything, and work priorities are slightly different. I mean, I'm very relaxed about a career path as such, but you know, I've got a bit funny after the first year and sort of wanted to kind of like aware of what's happening, what am I doing, am I contributing financially, am I doing anything like that? Yeah. It got a bit funny. This year, I took on a bit too much work, so I'm now going the other way around. It's like I'm wanting to go backwards again. So you I think, particularly men, maybe it's our egos are a little bit. We want a little thing. We feel when we, if you're more involved, there is a process I think where you feel somewhat emasculated by the process a little, just a tiny bit, varies in degrees, and that's not real really. It's just a sense of it's quite intense one-on-one time, and then you go back the other way, and I think it's about that balancing act, compromise.
Kind of like what you're saying resonated, because the biggest myth I sold myself was once the baby comes, I can still do my own thing.
Because
when she was pregnant, it was fine. Because she wanted to go to bed early, so I was going gym, I was playing football.
Yeah.
I seen my mates, and I was thinking, all right, cool, the baby will come. I'll send to my football team, there might be a few.
I remember that combo.
I sent to my 17, maybe.
I remember that combo.
Like, my mate, he's got two kids, and he was telling me, like, oh, yeah, smash out gym now, yeah. Because, trust me, there's dad book for a reason. Up at 4 in the morning, eating a Snickers, thinking, what happened to my life here? And I was like, nah, man, it won't be me. Like, I've got this. I wait to find time. You know, I don't need to sleep. I'll work out. I seriously deluded myself so much that literally the first week the baby come here, after the first week, I was like, Yeah, Jim ain't having any.